lunch as well. So we're a little bit behind, and we're probably going to try to make up some time on this panel if we can. I'm Tim Power, and it's a real pleasure to chair this panel on labor informality, political implications, and long-term prospects. And although I have only 30 seconds to do so, I cannot but add my congratulations as well to President Garcia, because it's my chance to say thank you once again. One of the great, most satisfying moments of my career at Oxford was signing the convenio with you in 2011, and we very much appreciate your commitment to the Latin American Center. We have three speakers. Two of them are former senators, and Dave Doyle, of course, is a future senator from the Irish Upper House. Ex-senators. So our first is Senator Carlos Aminami from Chile, and he has advised us that he's going to speak in Spanish, but actually he's going to speak in Chilean Spanish, which is the acid test for all interpreters. So if anyone needs headphones, they're available at the back of the room. And Carlos, thank you very much for joining us. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much. First of all, thanks to the Latin American Center of Oxford University. Thanks to CAF, thanks to Andres, to Enrique. My English is not very good, so I prefer to speak in Spanish. I think almost everyone understands Spanish. And anyway, there is a translation. Voy a comenzar con una pequeña descripción de lo que está ocurriendo hoy día en América Latina.
Short description of what's happening at the moment in Latin America. I would like to mention that Latin America, between 2001 and 2008, lived through a golden time. Never before in Latin America we have had together democracy, growth, low inflation, even one digit, the reduction of the debt and the diminishing of the external debt, a strong decrease in poverty. We're talking about some 45-46% in 2002, some 28% in 2012-13, an expansion of the political sciences, an increase on the minimum salary, increase on education, and it's different. Some countries have the growth, some have the growth, but the one that had all these five factors, democracy, growth, low inflation, no debt, no poverty, this is definitely a golden era, and it's good news. But then the bad news arrived. There was an important change in a radical change in tendencies, and then we have a deceleration, a deadlock, a period of stagnation, and we live through a political crisis in most of the Latin American countries. The economy is complex. It has its own laws and regulation, and it's not easy to resolve. It can be eventually resolved within the political possibilities, but if the political quality is poor, then the possibility of resolving economical problems is non-existent. But the tendencies are long-term tendencies, I believe, regarding the labor market. This is a subject that is not a static subject. We have to refer to work, and work is part of an evolution. It's always something that is being discussed, that is modified a long time. We all know how work in the time of the Fordism, but there is a discussion of what will happen after this. What's going to happen to work? we got at the moment the immaterial tendencies in production. And in American Latin, in Latin America, we got the subject of informality, which is our second social problem after poverty and lack of equality. First decades of the 20th century were related to poverty. The second half, to the lack of equality. And from the 70s onwards, we discussed mainly the subject of informality. I believe that the subject of informality, something that I want to bring into discussion, is really a very old problem. But it's a new one at the same time. It's a new challenge regarding informality. It's what we could call a classical informality, and there is also a modern informality, which is probably not yet studied properly. Therefore, it's a concept that is still open, and it can be object to different types of definitions. Perhaps informal workers that are modern, but not necessarily have low salaries, and those are informal workers. The classical concept of informality is related to things that we have mentioned, self-employed work, no social protection, low productivity, low salaries, instability. But at the moment, I think something that we have to ask ourselves, in this moment with digitalization and artificial intelligence, there's going to be a revolution in the workplace. It's not going to disappear, the work, but it will appear in a different way. Everything that is to do with business, for instance, the world commerce is changing. The fact that is we are now bringing digitization, we are losing employment. For instance, in Oxford, in the engineering department, it is expected in the next two decades that 47% of the employee opportunities will be at risk of being replaced due to this automation and artificial intelligence. And also, it's expected that in the next 15 years, a third of the local workforce will disappear. According to the World Economic Forum, between 2015 and 2020, some 5 million jobs will disappear. This is what's happening, for instance, the sale of air tickets, remote diagnosis, remote control of patients, how the retail stores function, etc. Should one thing compensate the other? The destruction of the old jobs will give room as new jobs. This is a question, but there is a risk, which is some sort of technological unemployment may take place. But there is also a new informality with different types of jobs, perhaps what we would call atypical, perhaps a small food business, products online, recycling, and something like Uber. There are jobs for people that don't pay tax. I've seen this in UK. El sistema Uber is a prototype in the world, I think. There are 1 million workers involved in this activity. In general terms, all the subject that is now fashionable in the work market is the subject of flexibility, and this is close to the informality. Before, the informality was related to certain areas, to developing countries. But today, all the sectors, this informality, not just in countries, developing countries, this also happens in developed countries. Before, the informality was in some standalone economy. Now it can be linked to the formal sector. Therefore, there is not a total rigid separation between the formal and the informal sectors. At the moment, the mechanism of transmission of informality is to do with the activities of the businesses, externalization, and the barriers between employment and unemployment are disappearing. Therefore, informality is a present subject. Taking into account the global economy depends not just of the formal employment, but also the informal world through subcontracting, working from home, agency work. What are today the different dimensions, the quantitative dimensions of this phenomena? Globally, perhaps half of the workforce, the global workforce, has an informal conditions. Therefore, they don't have rights, low productivity, they have no social protection. But in Latin America, due to these golden years, the informality is falling down. The World Bank mentioned that 65% of the Latin American workers, they were 65%. Now, in 2015-16, they are 50%. But they are still on the classic informality, a large amount that exceeds 130 million. In Central America, 70%. And we have to take into account young people between 18 and 24, there are 30 million youngsters that are informal workers. And the essential informality is concentrated in informal enterprises, 31%, 11% in the corporate segment, and 5% in the domestic service. O sea, it means that within the formal enterprises, there is an important percentage of informality. And by sector, we can find them in construction, in commerce, restaurants, hotels, transportation. And in order to close, what are the consequences, social consequences, political consequences of all this? It's important to know that there is an important alteration in the relationship capital work, capital labor. Generally, it's not just instability and a weak workforce. These workers are also vulnerable, and even they live in poverty. They lack equality. The informality is linked with the lack of equality. It's a relationship in both ways in this aspect and brings instability, the informality. What are the consequences, the political consequences of this process of the informality of the workforce? This is linked to something that we've seen in the world, especially not only in the whole world, but also in Latin America. We have the phenomena of the different political tendency to give easy replies. Well, I understand that things like what happened in Colombia is related to this instability, to these social consequences. The Brexit problem in England is connected, and the anguish that the workers have in regarding the future is reflected on all those recent political phenomena. What does it mean, all this? It is important to remember what was said this morning. It is not enough to have the present public policies. We need to redefine them. there is some progress for more development and inclusive development, formalizing the self-employment. We have to think on new social policies, more innovative, second, third generation, and we have to take into consideration the recommendations of the ILO, ensuring a minimum level of social protection regarding health, security for children, a minimum wage for active people, and also basic security for all the people. And so discussion on all different pension systems, but I have no time to go into detail. I want to talk about the Chilean system that is used now by everybody in the world because it's a good system, the best system. The pensions is a different representative. The pension represents a third of the last salary. Some 2 weeks ago, a million people had a demonstration in Chile protesting against the system. This is a very important and present theme of discussion. And we have to pass from informality to formality with the right policies. Policies that will increase productivity, that bring in the capacitation of the workers with the right norms, with the right incentives, with the creation of enterprises, quick creation of new enterprises, and with the proper fiscalization, with the proper tax system. And to bring this all together and to an end, all these problems regarding technical definitions, etc., it is very difficult to say that this can be resolved within the crisis period that we are living in Latin America. At the moment, the discussions are taking place, how to resolve growth, how to resolve small things, that allowing the government to survive. The governments are having difficulties in survival. And this is a subject to be discussed, and is going to be with us for a long time. Thank you.
Gracias, Carlos. El objetivo de esta mesa es de considerar un poco Carlos, las implicaciones políticas.
We have to consider the political implications, and thank you for bringing all these subjects. And we will ask Cecil López to take the stage.
The only thing that I have similar to men is that I can't do two things at the same time. So I can't talk and manipulate the computer, so I ask for help, okay? Well, first of all, Enrique, I think you're going to be very happy because you will have exactly what one person needs when you move to another position, the satisfaction of la labor cumplida. I think you did it, okay? Muy bien.
Would you like to sit here?
No, me voy a parar. This is not an easy subject, believe me. Labor informality, political implication, and long-term prospect. Who's going to give me a hand? Oh, yeah, okay. Okay, since I know myself, I better get here, because otherwise I will. Okay, I tried to touch 4 points. The obvious one, that is, where are we now? The second, informality and social policies. The third one, informal labor and democracy, and some thoughts about what we can expect. Let's move to Latin America. Well, this is obvious. I just want to take exactly what we have heard the whole morning. We are not... Let's move to the other one. Ya, pasa. Ahorita nos coordinamos. Ya, pasa la otra. Okay, it's obvious we are in a difficult economic moment. It's obvious we are going to, as a region, we are going to decrease these 2 years, and then the perspectives are not very good. For Colombia, we're going to have 2%. The central bank just mentioned a lower rate of increase of GDP. Second, and this is what I think is more important, what's going on in terms of the social population? I think I have the same thing that you had, Angel. But the point I want to make here is that, of course, we have a decrease in poverty, we have an increase in middle classes, but what really is important is not to call the vulnerable middle classes. They are not middle classes. And this is one of the failures of the social policy. That policy was not able to move poor to middle classes. They moved to vulnerable. And that makes a lot of difference. Latin America is not anymore a region of full of poor people, but we are full of vulnerable people. And that has a lot of significance in this case. About informality, I was thinking this morning when I listened to the presentations, please excuse me, but I have to say what I thought. I am so glad that I'm not one of your, I'm not a student attending this seminar, because I will be completely confused. Say something. You're confused? For some of you, informality has decreased. For another ones, have increased. I mean, there are 10,000 of definitions about informality, so it's very messy. So I'm glad I'm not a student, and nobody's going to ask me about that. Okay, but informality is a problem. And then you see that Colombia, Mexico, and Peru, they have more than 2/3 of the population in the informal sector. If that is not a problem, then how do you call it? What I thought when I listened to you this morning, I said, okay, the thing is that I come from the part of the region where the things are very bad, and you come from the part of the region where the things are not so bad. Yeah, but it shows how Latin America is so complex and so heterogeneous that it's very difficult to make conclusions. Okay, so this is what we have now. No, let's see. We have the economy in bad shape, we have a new structure, social structure, and we have informality, for me, as a problem. You know, the problem with economies is that you can divide them between those who see the glass full or the glass half empty. Well, I am the one, I belong to the one that can see the glass half empty. Okay, let's go on. Okay, the point I want to make, and I really have thought about this, is what is the relationship between informality and social policies? Okay. Really, the big priority in Latin America has been to reduce poverty. Why? Because it is easy. What is very difficult is to reduce inequality, because you have to touch political and economic structures. You have to touch the rich. You have to touch those who haven't been touched in the way they should have been. Okay? For example, paying taxes, as Antonio. Okay. Then Latin America did it. He said, okay, let's reduce poverty. The dates about inequality, maybe in general terms you see some reduction, but when you see a country like Colombia, inequality is there. But anyway, no matter what happened with inequality, we are still the more unequal region in the world. This is not a sentence, this is something real. Okay, well, what were the two key instruments of social policy? First, the income transfers for the most poor. I was supposed to be for the most poor, because that became the main strategy. And the other one is the direct subsidies pay. This is something that Colombia has a very example. These direct subsidies are given to a population that will receive the same services that the formal sector that pays for it. So for me, that's a huge cause of informality, and we'll see why. When you see what are the benefits of these income transfers that have been, we had had 2 decades now of income transfers. So we have, of course, it increases demand for social services, more children attend school, more health services where for kids and the other group of young people, and more seniors are covered. In Colombia, I make fun because you have familias en acción, jóvenes en acción. Viejitos en acción. I got furious. I said, how come if you're old, you have to be in action? No, they finally changed the name. Okay, what are the costs? No, I mean, it wasn't fair, or no? Okay, so no effort, the cost. And this is something José Antonio wrote in a paper that was published by CAF. There hasn't been a similar effort to improve the quality of education or to improve the quality of health. That's true. And one point that hasn't been studied, because women, again, are in the back of the whole story in Latin America, this income transfer reinforces women's traditional roles. And here comes the big issue of care economy. Do we want women to be kept in the traditional roles, or we want them to have autonomy? In Latin America, 30% of the women do not have any income. So they don't have autonomy. In case of men, they only have 10% of men that do not have any kind of income. And I think this has something that we should study, a negative impact on women's labor market participation rate. When the World Bank and IMF, and I don't know if you or OECD, that are the new bad guy in Latin America for some of us, when you talk about full employment, you forget that 50% of Latin American women in the age that should be in the labor market, they are not. So we still have a big problem there. Okay, now what happened with the health direct subsidies in Colombia? Look, what are the benefits? I mean, if I belong to the informal sector, I have the same access, theoretically, to the health services that the formal sector pays for. Part the how do you say patron? The what?
The boss.
The boss and the worker. Okay. Then what happened? Okay, we have universal coverage now. Especially for urban and rural poor. What does that mean? Everybody has a paper that is supposed to give you, to allow you to have good health. Well, that's not true, but at least you have that. You didn't have that before. But what's going on? We have a really serious financial crisis of the system, not only because of this, but because of corruption and other things. But anyway, this is something is there. We have bad quality in the services, and what worries me is the incentives to formality. I want to go back to the linkage I want to make between the actual social policy and the informality rate. I mean, the difficulties of reducing informality, if you want to put it that way. Why? Because if there is no way, if you are poor, and in Colombia, there was a study, a recent study by IDB that shows that the larger percentage of people that receive subsidies are non-poor. So you see how corruption works. Okay, but then what happened? If you belong to the informal sector and then you're receiving health services, if you have the opportunity to have a formal employment, you're going to lose the possibility of having those subsidies. But you know how the formal employment cannot be permanent. And there is no way to go back to the subsidies. So many people, and this is very true for domestic service, they prefer to stay in informal sector. They don't allow the boss to pay the contribution for health because they will lose the possibility to belong to that. This is incredible in Colombia, and this is one of the things that we have to change. There is a study recently done by these guys that shows that in the last decade, increases in labor informality can be attributed to this type of social policy from 1.9 to 3.2 percentage points. So the point I want to make is that income transfers in Colombia is an incentive for poor workers for not entering the formal market. Okay. So what I want to put as something that I know this is, you have to work more on that, is that current social policy in Latin America could help explain why informality levels in the region do not decrease. But this is just one part of the point. Now, let's see how do you jump from informal labor to democracy. Okay, here, so if you're not confused enough, then use this, the four schools that define informality, okay? But anyway, what I wanted to say is that basically when informality is divided in these different schools or analyzed by these different schools, they only consider employers and employees as decision makers in informal labor. But what is the role of political actors in the informal sector? That's the point I would like to at least explore. Okay, let's go. Okay, if you understand democracy as an organization in which everyone has access to equal rights, yeah? If you use that, how can you talk about democracy in a region where you have such a huge percentage of people that do not have access to rights? And then how can you talk about democracy when nearly 50% of the working population does not have labor rights, at least labor rights, okay? So what I'm trying to show is that this type of social policy implemented not only incentives for morality, but it's really clientelism. And there is where politicians come in. And I try to use the Colombian experience and to make some regressions to show you something to see if this at least contributes to open the debate. Colombian experience. Voting became a business for the poor. You sell the vote, they put you transportation, they take you to the place, they give you lunch and all that. That's the way voting, democracy is understood. That's what happened now. Politicians did not move because that election, the referendum election, was not important for them. So what did they do? They didn't pay any, they didn't put any buses, they didn't pay anything, so people didn't go out to vote. Even people that wanted to vote but live very far away from the places they were supposed to deposit the vote, they couldn't do it because they were not means to get there. Okay, so what happened? The way democracy is understood is that, okay, you sell your vote, you receive some money, and then the politician has a lot of control and power, and also it has a lot of, it has money, business going on. Okay, so what I would like what happened? As a result of these social policies and informal labor conditions, what happened? These transfers are used by the politicians. You see it in Colombia. How can you explain that the people that receive Familias en Acción and all this in Acción is about what? It will represent something like 60% of the population. Yeah, which means that poverty should be there and not in 28%. So you have a lot of people that shouldn't be receiving that, but politicians use them. So what happened with these people? These people are manipulated by politicians, and you call that democracy? That's my point. So if you keep on implementing those type of policies in which these subsidies are used by politicians to condition the vote, you are moving from informality to a lack of democracy. Here I try to make some correlations to see if we could start seeing something. The first one is corruption and labor informality. Corruption here defined by Transparencia Internacional defines corruption as the use, the mal uso of public resources by politicians. That's why I like the definition. Then you have that when you have less corruption, you are over there, and when you have high corruption, you are here at the 25? I can't see it, yeah. Okay, then high corruption here is, it is correlated to high informality, okay? And then you see the case of Guatemala, Honduras, that have high, that have high informality and has a lot of corruption. And then you move to Uruguay. Uruguay is the only country that really is behaving in a different way in which it has low informality and low corruption. Then we try another correlation. It's just a simple correlation. It really needs more work. But anyway, I thought it was interesting. Education, attainment, and labor informality. Here, what we measure is the gap that exists between different levels of education. So if you have a great disparity, a big gap in education, between the formal and informal, then you have more informality. If you don't have a wide range, you have low informality. But the one that I like more is the next one. This is just, these are tips to work more on this issue. This is political rights and labor informality. Okay, then one is when you have all the rights. And seventh is 4.5 here. Seven, it will be you don't have any rights. And then you see, when you have all the rights, you have low informality, and you have no rights, you have high informality. So what it means is that really informality, it has, at least you have some idea that you can find a relationship between labor informality and democracy, if you define democracy as access to the rights, okay? Yeah. Okay, now I'm gonna. So the hypothesis I would like to work, because I think this is still just an initiative, is that the type of social policies that you have, in which income transfers and direct subsidies are the priority, will increase informality because there is no flexibility moving back and forth, and then this undermines democracy if by that you define the impossibility of being free to elect or not elect, okay? What will be the long-run perspectives? And I'm finishing. Okay, so is informality going to finish? I think it's very difficult because we have very slow path to recovery. But the positive thing is that if you have 38% of vulnerable people and you have 29% of poor people, you cannot give transfers to two-thirds of the populations. I mean, income transfers to two-thirds of the population are fiscally impossible, politically impossible. That is the good news. You have to change social policies. I think that in that sense, we agree, Carlos, with the fact that we have to do it different. So the positive thing is that these current social policies, having the vulnerable as the most important group, this is not sustainable due to fiscal limitation and political environment. If we know that informal people are manipulated through these policies and they do not exercise the right that they should exercise. So the point that is behind all this is that you cannot leave, that's something we are working in CISOE, to only the traditional social policies, the well-being of the people. That's not enough. You have to start looking at the quality context of the macro policies and of many sectoral policies. We have worked with CAF in this talking about infrastructure and equality. Okay, we have to think in a wider sense. Then we have to move to more universal social strategies. So we have all the principles that we have forgotten. We, of course, we will still have to vocalize some to the very poor, but we have to be sure we are not going to have people that shouldn't be there, as is happening now. I think we have to bring back the debate about labor market and informality. And why? Because this is a way to talk about something that in Latin America is not an issue, democracy. In Latin America, there is no a debate, a serious debate about what's going on with democracy. Yeah. My final thoughts, well, I think we have to think about, and I want to summarize this in the last sentence, we have to talk about flexibility or rights. I think this is the debate about the labor market. What are we going to do? Flexibility didn't solve informality. So we have to talk now, we have to link this issue with equality, so we should talk about democracy and we should talk about labor rights. And I will end with a sentence in which I say, democracy does not breed informality, but nor can it solve it. Yet informality deeply impacts democracy. That's my hypothesis. When citizens surrender their political rights. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Very good.
Thank you very much, Cecilia. We'll now have our final presentation by David Doyle. I just want to take the opportunity to thank Dave again for all his hard work on this. This event is Dave's brainchild, and we're very grateful to your efforts. Thanks.
So thank you very much, Tim. It's great to be here. This is probably the first, well, this is the first and the only time I'm sure I will ever share a panel with two senators, so it was a real pleasure. This is based on work that a larger project that I'm working on with a colleague and friend who's sitting at the back of the audience, Néstor Castaneda-Angarita, who works at University College London. We have an agreement. Everything in this presentation that you like, I will take responsibility for. And everything that you dislike, Néstor has agreed to take responsibility for. So you should direct any angry questions towards Néstor. So political scientists have plenty of jokes about economists. I've decided I'm not going to tell them in this context because there's far too many economists in over there. But one of the things that we would often suggest economists don't do, and I think Diego touched upon this earlier, is ignore the political implications of many of the things that we have been discussing. Because yes, we can decipher a threshold at which we can see increases in formalization. Yes, we can come to some econometric measure at when we increase a certain level of income tax that this is going to give rise to increased formalization. But of course, this ignores the fact that there's very complicated political dynamics at play in these countries. So this project that Néstor and I began, and now involves Cassie Schwartz, who's also at University College London, is to try and get at some assumptions. And these assumptions are at least to explore some assumptions that we might have. And these are that your position in the labor market is going to affect your political preferences and the parties that you might support. There's obviously huge heterogeneity here, as we were talking about. There's massive heterogeneity in the types of jobs and things that people do in the informal labor market. But nonetheless, your position in the labor market is going to affect some of your political preferences. This gives different incentives for politicians to actually try and secure or win the vote of some of these, what we might call outsiders, people traditionally left outside traditional social structures, people who may not have strong links with existing or traditional political parties. So these groups become political game, as it were. And what we're interested in is the degree to which parties make some sort of appeal to these individuals, and how they then balance the type of policies that they deliver from a fiscal perspective, and what this means at a macro level. So we're interested in a number of things. The individual preferences of those in the labor market, we're interested in how this manifests itself in some type of political outcome, and what this means at a macro level for specific types of policy. As Professor Ocampo demonstrated earlier, what we have seen over the last 20 years in Latin America is a big increase in social spending. And this increase has occurred under both left-leaning administrations on this side of the graph and under all other types of administrations. It's more exaggerated under governments that we might call left, and the slope is slightly higher. But all governments have increased social spending over the course of the last 20 years. So that's one thing I think we're all in agreement. And this expansion of social spending is partly because existing welfare regimes at the beginning of the 90s, most of them reflected the risk that was embedded during the period of import substitution industrialization among certain social sectors, so the kind of Bismarckian system that Angel was talking about. And as a consequence, this meant that by the beginning of the period of democracy, many people were left outside these social structures. And there has been a big move to incorporate those left outside these structures through a whole host of different mechanisms that we talked about this morning, non-contributing programs, targeted social poverty release, and of course different aspects of universalism. And political scientists in the last couple of years have become very concerned with the political effect of this expansion, because we know that this has become a real electoral incentive for politicians. You can win an awful lot of votes, plausibly or potentially, by expanding social programs, by including people who traditionally were left out of these social structures. And a number of studies, Candelaria Garay at Harvard, Matthew Carnes, Isabel Mares, all of these have suggested that this incentive is particularly strong for parties on the left. Left-leaning parties have a strong incentive to try and expand, engage in various forms of universalism in order to incorporate these outsiders and formal workers, because this means that they will benefit at the polls. Now, I'm going to talk in a very general sense, and this is a graph that none of you can probably read, but what the kind of central point of this graph is to demonstrate, based on individual level survey data across the region, that those who, regardless of how we measure informal workers or informality, that those who are informal are much more likely to support left-leaning parties. So if we ask them, which party would you vote for in an election, they are much more likely to support parties that are left on a tax versus spending dimension. So this would seem to suggest that for informal workers, and we're talking in very, very general terms here, and there's huge heterogeneity, and there's heterogeneity across income levels also, what we find is that they are much more likely to support left-leaning parties, all else equal. And this is relative to other members of the labor force. This is relative to formal sector workers, and this is relative to some other categories within the labor force. If we look at the preferences of informal workers, so the preferences of informal workers towards specific types of social policies, as Cecilia, you were alluding to, we see that they do seem to have reasonable, discernible preferences and preferences that are slightly different. What I will say is that this data is really poor. I definitely am in agreement with economists when they say that we need more data, because this particular data that we use, this individual-level public opinion data, is actually very poor. But even on the basis of this, we can see some differences. When it comes to pensions, informal workers, again, relative to formal sector workers, or formal workers, are much less likely to support pensions. In general, although for those who self-report, or those who are informal, that is, with no health insurance, they are less likely to support unemployment benefits. And unsurprisingly, we see that those who either self-report as informal or who work for themselves and have no health insurance are much more likely to support subvention for the poorest within these societies. And again, this is relative to other workers within the labor force. So all of these measures are relative to other workers within the labor force. So this suggests that there are discernible differences in the type of policy preferences that informal workers are looking for. There's huge heterogeneity, both at the country level and across incomes within these measures. But what we do see is that those in the poorest income and the lowest income deciles tend, across the region, to support specific types of social policies, social policies that differ from those who work in the formal labor market. So what does this mean? What are the implications of all of this? Well, how are governments going to pay for these policies? So it was easier during the commodity supercycle to actually use the commodity boom to pay for many of these policies. But not all countries were able to benefit to the same extent as a consequence of this supercycle. And how do you pay for social policies aimed at very large informal sectors when it's quite difficult to raise income tax? There's just a simple mechanical effect here, that you can raise income tax, but the proportion of the population that you can actually raise this income tax from is quite small. And there's also an electoral cost to raising income tax, because one of the few things we do know in political science is that if you give something to someone, they are thankful and they will vote for you. But if you take something away from someone, they really get very angry and they will probably never vote for you again. And so income tax can be a very politically costly thing to do for many parties across the region. And we talked this morning about, you know, if you just raise income tax and we'll solve informality, the issue, of course, is how do you do that? How is any party going to do that at the potential electoral cost that they may face? And on top of this, in some countries, it's difficult to make that trade-off with some type of corporate tax. In other countries, in countries where business is less organized or where business is less centrally coordinated, it's easier to shift that burden onto capital. But in some countries where business is quite well organized, there are notable structural constraints for governments to actually do this. So this limits the options or the policy options that governments have in order to try and pay for these types of electoral incentives that they are facing. And the issue then is what does this mean for the progressivity of policy? Because what's very important is not just the type of social policy that you deliver, but how you actually pay for that social policy. And the manner in which the fiscal instruments that you use to pay for that social policy can have serious regressive consequences. So, if we look at informality, everybody has shown various. This is just based on data from CEDLAS, and it just shows the variation in informality across the region. If we look at informality, we see that it varies significantly across the regions, but in some countries it's really very high. And so what we would suggest is at the beginning of the commodity supercycle, governments had a real incentive and the opportunity for the first time to pay for policies to incorporate some of these outsiders, what we call those left outside these social structures, mainly informal workers who didn't have access to the social security or the formal mechanisms of social insurance. At the same time, a whole range of work from Nestor and Ben Ross Schneider at MIT has suggested that there are some economies which is very difficult. There's not that much space for governments to move when business has significant negotiating or structural power. And we've had some guests here in Oxford over the last year or two, some former ministers in the region, who have made this exact argument, actually, that they really felt constrained in the type of policies that they were able to enact. And Of course, the degree to which they're able to do that will depend on their organization and coordination. So this leaves all governments with reasonable limited funds, I think, to fund these non-contributing programs or move towards universalisms. And particularly for left governments, who seem to be the ones who have benefited most, or it seems to be the ones who have made greatest strides in trying to incorporate these informal outsiders across the region. And of course, this leaves them with few options. And one of the options they have, and it's one of the easiest options, and it's just simply technically efficient, is the use of indirect consumption tax. This is less electorally costly. We know that social policies for voters are immediate. They are very tangible. If you give something to someone, they will notice it. They will appreciate it. Income tax is very clear to voters. If you take something away from them through income tax, that can be quite electorally costly. But other types of indirect tax are notoriously complex. And we know that voters struggled, actually, to make the link between indirect taxation and between different types of governments who are responsible for them. So they struggle to attach accountability to different forms of indirect taxation that might be implemented. And this means that depending on the country and the context, there may be a regressive effect. Because what you may be doing, on one hand, is expanding social incorporation, including outsiders in your social model, including informal workers in your social model, but doing so through regressive tax instruments, consumption tax. And I say regressive because depending on where you are in the income decile, so if you're at the end of the income decile, you're going to consume a larger proportion of your income, or you're going to lose a larger proportion of your income through a flat consumption tax than those at the higher end of the income decile. And this is not unique, actually, to Latin America. Some colleagues here in Oxford, David Rueda, Pablo Beramendi, who has now left and has gone to the US, they have also observed that this is the type of policies that we're observing in some European countries. We mentioned the Nordic countries this morning, and they have made the argument, and they have some data to back this up, that this is also what is happening in the Nordic countries. That, in fact, because of the power of labor unions, it's very difficult politically to raise income tax, and so they have shifted the burden of taxation onto consumers, this indirect consumption tax, and this is how they are paying for many of these social welfare regimes in Northern Europe. This is a huge table of figures, which wine at lunch is not conducive to reading. So, but what it suggests is that while there is significant variation in corporate income tax, in personal income tax, and VAT, we are tending to see a reasonable convergence on certain types of tax instruments. This is just divided by three regions, the Southern Cone and Brazil, Central America, and the Andean region, and this is the average rate of income tax, so the mean rate of income tax. This is the mean rate of VAT, and what we are seeing is that over time, we are seeing decreases in the mean rate of income tax, and again, with huge national variation, and a general increase in consumption tax. And again, this is not confined to Latin America. Governments across the world are increasingly using consumption tax to collect revenue because it's cheap and it's easy. And if we look at the mean corporate tax rate, again, we see the same steady decline. So what does this mean? Well, it means that this is just purely descriptive, and this is one of the things that we seem to be observing. So what we are doing here is just giving you a description of what we have observed thus far. And what we seem to have observed is that depending on the degree of labor informality and depending on the degree to which business is able to really exert its preferences in an economy, we see very different types of both social policies and taxation strategies pursued specifically by left governments. And I'm talking about left governments here because we have expectations that they would favor specific tax strategies over others. They should favor, at least according to our traditional comparative political economy perspective, to shift the burden of taxation from workers onto capital. And what we see is that where levels of informality are reasonably low, we see social systems and social security mechanisms that protect insiders, to protect those with formal sector employment. But when we have very high levels of labor informality, what we seem to observe is a shift towards indirect taxation. And if we just look at some simple data based over the last 20 years on the total tax revenue as a percentage of GDP and also social spending as a percentage of GDP, we can more or less see those types of trends played out here, where indirect taxation is quite low, direct taxation is higher. We see very high levels of social security and health and education. And here, while we see moves towards higher levels of moves towards certain types of universal policies, but also very high levels of indirect taxation. And if we look at this more formally, and again, this is after lunch is not the time to try and introduce these graphs, but what this shows us is that left governments, relative to right governments, collect far more tax revenue, and this is what we would expect, this is what we should expect as political economists, until we reach a certain level of informality. And at a certain level of informality, that difference between left and right governments disappears. And it's more interesting if we disaggregate this by direct and indirect taxes. When it comes to direct tax revenue, again, we should expect the left to prefer to engage in direct tax revenue because depending upon how it's designed, it is assumed to be more proportional and more progressive. They collect higher levels of direct taxation up to a certain level of informality. And if we look at this, in levels of indirect taxation, we observe a similar type of trend. The left collect less indirect taxation up until a certain level of informality when they actually collect more indirect taxation than right-leaning governments. And what we would suggest is that this is partly to fund this electoral incentive that they have to expand social spending, but in doing so, this may have all sorts of regressive implications. And that's not for us to calculate. We leave that, of course, to the economists. But how do they balance this electoral incentive? Well, one thing we would suggest is that it probably lies in the degree to which voters are able to untangle the effects of income tax and indirect tax and the different strategies that government might employ, which they believe will be least electorally costly to them, the easiest things that they can do to win votes and yet deliver social policies that people are asking for. And if we look at the effect of business, this effect is actually magnified even further. So just to finish off, this is a description, a descriptive characterization of what we are observing given the data that we have. And it's data that comes from many of your organizations. But some of this is just mechanical. Some of this is just simply mechanical in that the larger the informal labor market, the smaller the degree of income tax you can actually engage with. But it does suggest there is some sort of policy trade-off for governments who are keen to incorporate these types of informal workers. But there's lots of problems here. We are making very large assumptions about preferences with really shaky data. So we're using publicly available public opinion data, which is not very good, which is all sorts of issues. CAF actually has got a survey which is very useful. It's much better quality data. But the data that I'm showing you here, it's very difficult, first of all, to actually determine who is informal, because if you self-report as informal, that's also going to have an endogenous effect on your attitudes towards certain types of welfare policies or programs. And there are other ways to redistribute and win votes. We're talking about policies at the national level, but a big thing that has emerged in very recent times in the last year or two has been the importance of what we call forbearance. And that is the deliverance of local-level benefits in order to win votes. And what we mean by forbearance is forbearing on certain types of regulations, in enabling those small informal sector businesses to continue operating without having to pay or without having been strangled by certain types of legislation. And this type of forbearance can be a way to deliver or redistribute and win votes without having to engage in some of the macro level trends that we're talking about here. But what happens at the national or local, or what happens at the national level? How do these preferences manifest themselves at the national level? And that still remains something of a black box. And what we need to do is we need to understand the position of the labor market and how this shapes attitudes towards certain types of tax versus trending, spending trade-offs. Do people even make these types of trade-offs? Do they make the distinction between receiving something in return and then having to maybe losing some of their income in some type of consumption tax? And how might all of this then translate into electoral behavior? And thankfully, Nestor and I, the British Academy, are very graciously funded us to run a big survey experiment in Mexico City, which we hope to do in December, which will be the first kind of next step in this project in trying to understand some of these dynamics. Thank you.
You may.
I won't divide the countries in left or right. I will divide them.
Yo no dividiría los países en
because the model is not generated employment, so the way to solve it is what to do with the poor, let's give them income transfer, because not necessarily government. For example, Colombia is not, you could not call Colombia government a left.
And my co-author is from Colombia.
Well, huh?
My co-author is Colombia.
So I won't make that difference, okay?
Thank you very much. So we have about 20 minutes for questions and answers, comments from the audience. Please feel free to ask your question in either English or Spanish, but I just ask that you wait until the microphone arrives to you so that the audio and the interpreters have access. Comments or questions from the audience?
No questions.
No comments.
Thank you. Hello, thank you for your presentations. Thank you, David. It's a very interesting presentation. I want to ask you, I mean, what's the reason behind, or the rationale behind the preferences of workers for low levels of pension or unemployment benefits? I mean, it's similar to days of here in Europe. I mean, they don't like pensions, let's say, or unemployment benefits because that raise the price of labor or because they don't want to pay for that?
Thank you. We'll collect a couple questions. Any other questions or comments? Yes, please, Sonia. If you have the microphone here. Thank you.
Bueno, ya queda una posibilidad de cualquiera de los dos idiomas. Voy a elegir el que me siento más cómoda.
I'm happy speaking Spanish.
Me parece súper interesante la diversidad.
I think that is very interesting to see the diverse opinions, people from many different places with different opinions, and thanks for so much information. And I'm thinking that when you said that is difficult, once you give something to somebody, it's difficult to then take it away. It's an interesting point. I believe that, such as Angel said, one of the ways to implement policies is to do it gradually, not from one day to the next, say, you no longer have such and such a benefit. But for people that is receiving these transfers, I believe that the way to bring them to an end is through education. If people really come to understand the value of a pension or their rights as a person, as a woman, if the woman will start understanding her own rights, they will not prefer living on social transfers. This doesn't allow you to lead a life free of worries. Investing in education, probably you could take away people from the system. And going now to the other extreme, it's difficult to take something away once you've given it. But as Cecilia said, how can you charge a rich person that never paid tax, now you have to pay? Well, this is also difficult. It's difficult not only politically, but many times the politicians themselves are in that situation. The challenge is a double one. I'm thinking perhaps in Paraguay, a country with a lot of inequality, and they did not have an income tax, which implemented then in 2012 with quite a lot of problems. The fiscal impact has been low, but has produced an indirect impact because they started thinking that perhaps instead of paying the tax, you should take it away from your expenses. So people, when they went shopping, started asking for the receipts, which was something not done before. And this is an incentive for formality. It's obviously, it has some regression regarding IVA, but perhaps it's bringing in the making people conscious of the contribution. The amounts in the future may change. But I believe there are ways to get there. And another question from me.
Bueno, dos cosas malas que tengo, ser economista y argentina,
I'm an Argentinian, and I am an economist. Not good things to be. I don't know when we speak about left-wing governments. I'm not too sure how to define it. What is a left-wing government?
Una. At the back there, please. And Nestor, since you're a co-author, feel free to jump in anytime. No, go ahead there, please.
following up on the previous question and about the links between politics and informal economy, I think two of the speakers have made, all of you actually have made that link. And thinking about the Latin American context and political rights and populism and sometimes I've heard in seminars that people defending that populism is a Latin American way of being democratic. So how do we address the political rights and political agency and civil rights and social security and social protection in the Latin American context? And as all of you have said, that if the politics is not right, how can we get the economy right?
Okay. Those are all small questions. Okay, thank you. So, Carlos, would you like to start us off?
Would like to start with the last point. I believe that now, at this stage, is quite difficult to define a left-wing government. But I would say that in the last 10 years, we spoke about progressist governments that look with good or bad results, in a good or bad way, different. They look for policies, social policies, and there were different ways to do so that could be criticized. But what I notice that what is coming now into Latin America is a conservative wave, and these social issues seem to be becoming less important. For instance, in Argentina, Macri came into power promising zero poverty, while in the last year and a half, it has been an increase of a million and a half poor people. It is important the impact of the social policies in democracy. There are new middle classes. People that came out of poverty, but they are not yet middle class, but they are no longer poor. They are something else. They are emerging group of perhaps 40 million in Brazil, many million in Chile. And I believe that one of the elements that is difficult in democracy is the behavior and the demands of that sector that has left poverty, but they have new demands, not just education, but good education, not just health, but good health care. And we need a government that can offer and satisfy this request. In our countries, our social problems are from this challenge are with this sector that has left poverty behind. I would like to make Quisiera hacer un comentario. I'm going to speak Spanish. Coming back to people that are vulnerable, I believe that the important challenge in social policy in Latin America, if this is the most important group in the region, in most countries, more important than the poor or the middle classes, how are we going to look after them with the same social policy, with the same subsidies, with the same systems? The fiscal code cannot be moved, and there is a new connotation regarding cost of democracy. Latin America, as we said this morning, we got the same concentration of income in Latin America without income that Europe without. So it's a problem. We have it in Colombia, payment of tax. We are going to start creating tax on dividends. And we are thinking of a VAT tax and so on. But I believe that it's interesting for those that fought for universal policy. We need for that the support of the fiscal support. And it is important to understand that you cannot still talk about some marginal sectors that need the support with social policy. The whole thing is more complex. You have to come to a revision of all these policies that call themselves neutral. Nobody has the solution, but we do have to come and talk about the new social strategies that will consider these groups that are very active groups and are going to be demanding more than the poor people did. I think this is a critical point. I want to make questions about populism and democracy in Latin America and the connection with agency and the capacity of the workers to be able to live their lives claiming their social rights. And I want to talk about the conditions of in Latin America. What is the left? What is social democracy? I don't know if I understand you, but in Latin America, we're not discussing democracy. 2 days ago, Correa spoke about Venezuela. He had an interview, and he was furious when somebody said that Venezuela is a democracy because Maduro was chosen by the people. That's the concept of democracy. But then you can see that it's very low participation of the people, and one wants to know who is the vulnerable part. A link there. And the central theme is that we have in Latin America a democracy or not. I don't believe so. In certain countries, we not do not talk about Colombia. Colombia, the oldest democracy in Latin America, but we have to link this with social policy. But regarding education, if we are going to rely on education, this will take a long time. We need to do something sooner. I don't not say it's not true that the benefits are not enough. There is support in Colombia for families, for youngsters, for all the people. There are families that are receiving more than the average salary on benefits, and I agree that. To say that if the president of Colombia tries to stop paying the benefit of for families, he will not last a day. You have to do things gradually. You cannot cut off a benefit. Everybody is talking about these benefits without thinking about the strategy.
So just I'll start at the end. So the question about populism and the question about politics and economics. I mean, I couldn't say what you need to do. I would never suggest what needs to be done. But I think clearly, as a political scientist, what you can observe is that there are incentive structures. And when those incentive structures are there, politicians will behave in a way that's not unsurprising. So as long as those incentive structures are there, they will behave in ways that we might intuitively expect. And I think you're right, that will have long-term implications. When it comes to what's left and what's populism, let's go back a little, I think, to both of you. We political scientists have libraries full of books just talking about what is populism and what's not populism. The Dornbusch and Edwards definition was all about redistribution, and that's largely been debunked now. We now know that that's not what we meant by populism. And there's probably a fine line between populism and being a popular, the introduction of policies that are popular, and between certain types of political organization. So it's very difficult to say. In some cases there's a much clearer distinction. In others, I think the distinction is difficult to make between what we might understand as left and what we might understand as popular or populism. When it comes to how we understand the left, in this context, so the reason, first of all, just the reason we were interested in disaggregating government strategies is because this is an active debate in political science. And we have clear expectations about how government should behave. Or at least we do have clear expectations in most cases. And some people have done work on how we might expect different governments to produce different types of policy outcomes. And in that context, we were interested in the degree to which left-leaning governments might actually engage in policies that would seem to be paradoxical. Because there is a paradox in terms of redistribution in the European context that people have begun to highlight. And how we understand and define this left, political scientists have lots of ways of doing this. In this particular context, we just use these big expert surveys. So we ask experts, that is other political scientists, whether a government A is left or whether a government B is right. Of course, what you end up doing, that it becomes tautological to the spending that they engage in, so you just end up assigning people left or right based on whether they spend or don't spend. So these measures are imperfect, but that was the reason that we created the divergence. When it comes to things like education and political sophistication, this has importance in all sorts of angles. It has an importance both in terms of the degree to which people are able to make a cognizant type of political trade-off or a cognizant type of trade-off between the fiscal instruments that governments use and the degree to which they actually get something in return. And that's all over the world. We know that this is how voters operate all over the world. But again, when it comes to the responsibility of governments to educate their systems about the different types of systems or tax systems that might be implemented, I would suggest there are different incentives for them to do this as well. There are incentives for them to do this and incentives for them to not do this. When it comes to the, why would members of the informal labor market not actually support things like pensions, for example, or things like unemployment benefits? I would say the answer here is twofold. One is that partly it's because the data is very poor. So the data asks people to what degree would you support a whole list of different types of policies. And I think part of it is probably is the fact that if you are a member of the informal labor market, and again, as I said, often what happens is when you self-declare to a particular type of labor group, your preferences become endogenous to that declaration. But I think what we probably also observe here is that why would you support some types of social policies that you don't actually benefit from and which you have never benefited from? So if the question was asked, would you support the expansion of pensions to you or to those who work with you, I think the answer would be different. But the way the question is currently phrased in the moment, it's whether you do support pensions as they currently exist or whether they currently are.
Thanks, Dave. I saw we have time for a couple more questions. I saw one here at the back, two at the back. First over here, please, and then in the back row.
Hi, hello. Thank you for your presentations. Given that you've talked about taxation as a big issue in this debate, and considering that this is the political panel, I would like to know how would you place this debate on taxation in regards to accountability and corruption, considering that these are two main issues that we have in the region.
Thank you. Yes?
Buenas tardes. Yo voy a hablar en español por ahora. Mi pregunta es referente al tema de la recolección de datos.
Is regarding data gathering. We saw in different presentation that is quite a challenge to have enough information in order to evaluate and the in order to implement to consider the public policies. But the gathering of data many times is the responsibility of the government that have the cost of implementing different public policies. The numbers of the research are not quite right always, and how can we have better indicators and to avoid the political influence on the data gathering in Latin America? Una pregunta más.
Okay, then I would ask each panelist if you could take 1 or 2 minutes to sort of wrap up. Carlos, would you like to begin?
No. Two
comments, one on populism and one on tax. In Latin America is a tendency to populism, which is based on two things. One is the fact that the institutions have lost prestige, that the political quality has gone down, and in the politics are looking for direct representation, establishing a direct relationship between the leader and the people without going through the political parties themselves. The prestige of the political parties is very low in Latin America, and it is an incentive to look for the direct contact with the people. And this also is a traditional traditional characteristic, which is the leader, a powerful leader. And there are important reasons that fit these populist tendencies, especially when there is an economical crisis. And something simple and obvious is always difficult to increase tax. It's always a good reason not to increase tax. When things are going well, is well, then they say, why increase tax when things are going right? And if things are going wrong, well, if things are so wrong, how are we going to increase now tax? It's going to make things more difficult. It's always a good reason why not to increase tax, and this makes things difficult. In Chile, we had the reform. Fiscal reform is not a fantastic reform, but it already generated an enormous amount of resistance. I believe that the fact that the state guarantees a good use of the resources, this is important, because there is a suspicion that tax will increase because there will be more public expenditure, etc. Regarding corruption and tax, how do you break the circle? Those that can pay tax don't want to pay because the money is stolen. Due to the level of corruption that we have in Latin America, and this is just a subject we will have to face seriously, because the new generations of criminals are not the drug traffickers in Colombia, but are people that work for the state, people with education, with a good financial status. And those are, we have to acknowledge that the taxation in Latin America is fairly low comparing here is 34. In Colombia, we got 11, 14, 15. It's low. We have to make an effort. People will have to understand in Colombia that they must pay tax. And what to do about corruption? Yes, you want to break the vicious circle. But in Colombia, just something happened, something serious. Those of us that are in certain place in government, we thought that what was said at the time of the referendum, that we didn't believe what was said for the referendum, and we didn't think that the people would believe it. But we were proved wrong. This confirms the fact that you don't only need figures. You have to go into the regions, know the people, see how they live. Otherwise, this is what happened. All the all the people of government believed that the vote would go one way, and it didn't. That's the reason. The data gathered by that person locked in a room is not enough. You have to go into the field, see how the people live. You have to, again, do all the data gathering from inside, because the distance in between one group of people and the other is just too far.
Just very quickly, I mean, these things with corruption, it's just very complicated. I mean, as we know, as Cecilia alluded to, there are incentives for even social policies will affect the incentive you have to actually remain in the particular type of work that you're doing. So when you add other things like corruption into the mix, I mean, then it becomes everything becomes very difficult to actually untangle or to begin to understand. And I'm no expert on corruption, and I'm no expert on this particular subject. But I think at the margins, what you will find, and is that that's probably going to exacerbate some of the dynamics that we have been talking about, I would suggest. But again, as I said, I'm no expert. I mean, data is an issue. I think we are realizing across the world that data is not just simply hard raw data. I think Fox News realized that quite hard at the last election when Barack Obama was elected. They realized that their opinion polls weren't as accurate as they thought. And that, when it comes to the data that we use, I'm sure there are issues with some of the data. I mean, Argentina, of course, has had a very well-documented issue with its data and things like inflation and stuff like that. But I think in the majority of cases, as someone who uses a lot of econometrics, I would suggest that a lot of it we could probably put into an error term. But yes, there are certainly issues with data, and that's why I would definitely agree with the economists in that we need more data and we need better data.
Great. Well, thank you very much to all three panelists, not only for the excellence of your presentations, but also for helping us to gain time. And that means good news for you, because now it's time for coffee. So before we go across to the Hilda Best building, it's going to be served in the lobby of the building right there. Please join me in thanking our panelists.